Hello, everybody. This is Alex May from Ruhr University Bochum, and you are listening to the talk How to Meet Ternary LWE Keys. So, what do I mean by ternary LWE keys? So, we are given a n-dimensional square matrix A and a target vector B, and we have the usual LWE identity A times S is B plus E for some unknowns S and E, where S is the secret and E is the error vector, and they are both n-dimensional ternary vectors, and your goal is to find the n-dimensional ternary secret vector S. So many efficient crypto systems use secrets with this bounded range, like our ternary keys. And in this talk, we will especially address N2 versions, but there are more versions in the paper, like the signature schemes BLIS and GLP. And for the moment, we'll assume that S and E are random ternary vectors. Also, our results apply to larger fixed ranges, like if we add plus minus twos, and I will give you an example on the last slide for the BLIS signature schemes. And our results also apply to variants such as ring LWE and module LWE, which only makes them slightly better, but we will ignore these effects throughout this talk. And in this talk, we will address a very elementary question: what is the combinatorial complexity of finding S? And by combinatorial complexity and combinatorial algorithms here, I mean meet-in-the-middle algorithms. But before I start with the meet-in-the-middle algorithm, let us address the most simple algorithm, namely brute force algorithm. So here we start with the LWE equation A times S is B plus E, and now we search in the first step for all ternary S. And we check whether A times S minus B is actually again a ternary error vector, and in this case we output S. So graphically, that means we are looking among the columns of A for a ternary linear combination denoted by S, which matches the target vector B up to some error vector E. And if we denote the search space size for our ternary keys by capital S, which is 3 to the n, then the running time of our algorithm is basically this S, which is 3 to the n, and we get polynomial memory. So how would we do now a meet-in-the-middle algorithm on this? So in the meet-in-the-middle, we would split A column-wise in dimension n, so we would look at the first n over two columns of A, denoted by A1, and the second N2, and we would also split S in dimension n half and n half. So this is depicted on the next slide. So here A is written as A1 and A2, and now we get an identity A1 times S1, S1 being of dimension n half, is equal to minus A2 times S2 plus B up to the unknown error vector E. And in an algorithm, this would mean we would enumerate all S1 now being of dimension n half and ternary, and we would construct a list L1 with all these candidates S1, and the left-hand side of our equation A1 S1, which we hash, and you will see why we hash in a minute. And the same we would do for S2. Again, being in half-dimensional ternary vectors, we would enumerate them, and the left-hand side minus, as the right-hand side, I'm sorry, minus A2 times S2 plus B, and we would hash that. So why do we hash? We need that the right-hand side equals the left-hand side up to our unknown ternary E, and this is done by locality-sensitive hashing, which was introduced by Odlyzko in 97. So as a consequence, we output all S1 and S2 such that they have the same hash value under our locality-sensitive hash function. And you can easily show that the running time is dominated by the list construction, which is because S1 and S2 now have dimension n half, 3 to the n half, which is the square root of the search space, but with the drawback that the memory is also the square root of the search space S. Okay, so now I will give you a brief introduction into the representation technique, which is actually the key for the further improvements on ternary LWE. So what is the main idea of the representation technique which was introduced by Hochreiter, Kramer and Zhu in the context of subset sum algorithms? It's that we split S now not in n half dimensional vectors S1 and S2, but we split S as a sum of S1 and S2, both being full n-dimensional ternary vectors. Here I give you an example. So look at this vector 1, 0, minus 1, 1, minus 1. And I split it such that both summands S1 and S2 obtain exactly 1, 1, and 1, minus 1. So this is depicted here, and you see four representations of S. Namely, I can split the first one as a sum, as I do in sum 1 and sum 2 of 1 plus 0, or as 0 plus 1 as I do in sum 3 and 4. And similar for the minus 1, I can write it as a minus 1 plus 0, which I do in sum 1 and 4, or I could write it as a sum of 0 plus minus 1 as I do in sum 3 and 4. Yeah, so this is what I called a representation zero. So basically, we represent the ones ambiguously by putting the ones either in the first summand or in the second summand, and the same for the minus ones. But notice that for the zero of our S, we always write it as zero plus zero. Now we could change that and even get more representations, and this is what I call rep 1. So we additionally represent the 0 as 1 plus minus 1 or minus 1 plus 1, and here's an example. So the green 0 is now represented as 1 plus minus 1. And you can think of more representations by using more digits for S1 and S2. So for instance, here I use 2s. So I represent the first 1 in S as the orange representation 2 plus a minus 1. Yeah, this gives us more representations, and the drawback is it's harder to enumerate over the S1 and S2, but the big benefit is that once we have R representations, then it's enough to compute only a 1 over R fraction of S. So why is that? So look at our four representations above. No matter which one of these we construct, they are all equally good because they all sum to the right target vector S. And that's already the magic of the representation technique, which was used heavily to improve our subset sum type problems. And here you see subset sum directly. So in the subset sum problem, you are given A1 up to An and a target vector T, and you have to find a subset of the AI that sums to T modulo 2 to the N. And here you see the algorithm. So the simplest algorithm is again brute force with complexity 2 to the N, and then you have meet in the middle 2 to the N half. And once you use representations, you can improve over this exponent, basically 1/3 for something similar to rep 0 before. And if you use more complicated representations like rep 1 or rep 2, you improve to 2.9 respectively 2.8, which was shown at AsiaCrypt last year. And it was also used for decoding. So you can consider the famous syndrome decoding problem as a subset sum type problem over F2 to the N. And then you have Pranger's algorithm from the 60s, which is a brute force algorithm. And then you have the Stern and Dumeur algorithm from the 90s and the Ball collision algorithm from Crypto 11, which are basically meet in the middle type algorithms. And then you have the MMT algorithm from AsiaCrypt 11, which you consider as sort of a rep 0 algorithm, and the BGMM algorithm, which is currently considered to be the best syndrome decoding algorithm from Eurocrypt 12, which you consider basically as a rep 1 algorithm. Now, since these representations were so fruitful for the subset sum type problems, and since ternary LWE is also kind of a subset sum problem because we have to find a ternary linear combination of the columns of A, the main idea is to use these representations here as well. So this is what we do, but there are two technical caveats. So for ternary LWE, it's not exact matching, but we have approximate matching. So there's some error that we don't know, which is different from subset sum. We have exact matching to T and also for syndrome, the decoding. And there's another technical caveat because Odlyzko's locality sensitive hashing is not homomorphic and that causes some problems, but I don't want to go into these details, but instead I want to show you now the main idea of our new algorithm, which is called Meet LWE for ternary LWE keys. So we want to use representation. So we use a full size splitting of S as S1 plus S2, both being n-dimensional vectors. So we get an identity A times S1 is minus A times S2 plus B plus the error vector. And the idea is now to check this identity on n minus coordinates approximately and on R coordinates exactly. And for these R coordinates, we have to know the R coordinates of the error vector E, which are denoted here by ER. So let's look, have a look at the algorithm, Meet LWE. So in the first step, you choose your preferred representation, rep 0, 1, or 2. And then there's a loop that guesses the R coordinates of E denoted by ER. And for every guess of ER, you now enumerate again all S1 within your representation and the left-hand side, A times S1, and for all S2, you enumerate the right-hand side minus A S2 plus B, and then you output all sums S1 plus S2 such that the meet in the middle identity AS1 is equal to minus AS2 plus B plus ER is exactly fulfilled on R coordinates, and it's approximately fulfilled on the remaining n minus coordinates, and this approximate fulfilledness you again check via Odlyzko's locality sensitive hash function. So the correctness of this algorithm should be now somehow clear to you. But what about the running time of this algorithm? Because here we have a loop where we guess R coordinates of E, and this might be a very bad idea. So let's look at this. So the running time of our meet LWE algorithm is actually denoted by capital T, and it's 3 to the R because it's the guessing part for guessing R coordinates of E, times for every of these guesses, we have to do a list construction and some matching. But recall that in the representation technique, we have to construct only a 1 over R fraction of the search space, where capital R is the number of representations that we have. And the right choice here in this identity 1 of small r, the number of coordinates that we have to guess, is the identity q to the small r is equal to capital R. And for all our representations 0, 1, and 2, we have that the number of representations big R is bounded by 2 to the O of n, and in LWE we usually choose q polynomial n. And all three identities imply now together from the first identity we get that R is log R to the base q, we write it to base 2, and then we plug in for R and q by identities 2 and 3. And this eventually gives us that the number of coordinates that we have to guess, small r, is slightly sublinear in n. And this is good news because our running time is 3 to the r, which is now slightly a sub-exponential in n, whereas the list construction time is fully exponential in n. So asymptotically, that means that our Meet LWE algorithm doesn't suffer too much from the guessing of R coordinates. So asymptotically, it's actually the list construction time. But for concrete parameters, like for entry parameters, we of course have to take the guessing into account. But let's start with the asymptotics first. So here I give some asymptotics, and for real cryptosystems, like the entry cryptosystems, usually we choose secrets of a smaller weight. So for random, let me first define what a weight is. So S has weight omega if S has omega times n non-zero coefficients. So for random s, you would expect that you have weight 2 over 3, but usually you choose a smaller weight, so having a smaller number of plus minus 1s in your secret. And here in the table you see some weights. So we start with extremely small weight, like 0.12, and then we also have weights in the range 0.38 up to full weight 0.69. And then we can compute the running time t for these weights, and you see here for the very small weight we obtain search space to the 0.3, but for the larger weights we have roughly search space to the 1 over 4. And this gives our theorem. So for these large omegas, our meat LWE achieves asymptotic complexity, which is a fourth root of the search space. It also has memory requirement, fourth roots of the search space. But if you compare, for instance, to the formerly best known combinatorial algorithm, which was at Lüskow's meet in the middle. So we had the square root of the search space. So that means our new result has another square root and we get the fourth root of the search space, which is already quite impressive. And you will see that this also translates to significant speedups in practice. So let's look at some entropy parameters. And here I have two parameter sets for you. So the first parameter sets are from the IEEE standard from 2008. And the second block of parameters is from the current NIST proposal of the ENTRO team, which is currently a final candidate in the standardization process. So you see in the IEEE standard, we have very small weights with weights 0.12 and 0.11. Search space is ranging between 400 bits and something like 877. And our results, though asymptotically, they should be search space to the 0.3, but in practice they are a little bit worse because we have to take the guessing into account. But we also compare to lattices, and you see here that our combinatorial algorithm actually improves our current lattice estimates that we have for this 2008 standard. And you also see that lattices are somewhat more sensitive for increasing the dimension, yeah? So the gap opens. So for the smallest dimension, we have a gap of like 5 bits, whereas for the largest dimension, which is around 1500, we have a gap of over 40 bits of this. But you also see, if you go to the NIST parameter sets, that our algorithm is very sensitive to the weight. So for instance, if you compare the first parameters of IEEE and NIST, then they are almost the same dimension. So you get for lattices almost the same estimate, but for our algorithm, the estimate is much worse. So it almost doubles the bit complexity here. Yeah, so the basic observation is that the hardness comes, or the lattices are very sensitive to the dimension, whereas our enumeration algorithm is very sensitive to the weight. Okay, so let's wrap up. So we improved over the ternary LWE meet in the meet algorithm from Otlushko, from the square root of the search space to the fourth root of the search space. And there's already a quantum version of our algorithm, which achieves the fourth root of the search space. And this is joint work with Iggy van Hoff and Elena Kirshanova from this year's PQ Crypto. Our algorithm improves upon current lattice estimates in the small weight regime, but not in the large weight regime that was proposed by the ENTRO's team, which seems to be a good choice. So they kind of anticipated our new algorithm. And our algorithm also has potential applications for side channel attacks, where you get an approximation of the secret and you're left with a small weight regime. And we show more generalizations in the paper. So for instance, we show more time memory trade-offs using parallel collision search, and we also give a bliss example including non-ternary keys with plus minus twos, and there we get classically a very promising result. So we also get the fifth root of the search space which seems that our algorithm generalizes quite well for that. But this also brings us to the open problems. So to generalize as to arbitrary max norms and to analyze this, it seems that we need new mathematical methods, because our methods get very, very messy if you add new digits for s. And there are two more interesting open questions. So one is, can we close this gap between asymptotics and practical parameters that comes from guessing of small r coordinates? Is that really necessary, or can we remove that? And last but not least, now we have a combinatorial algorithm which is best for the small weight regime, and a lattice reduction algorithm which is best for the large weight regime. So is there a hybrid algorithm that gives you the best of both worlds? And that's all. Thanks a lot for your attention, and goodbye.